We went to work on a picture that actually boasted the very first totally new built sets since the war, because they've been revamping all the sets, you know, but actually for this film they designed totally new sets, and the whole thing was very lively and very pleasant. And we had a rather unique director, John Farrell. Miss Russell was a very strong individual and very good humored when she wasn't cranky. And we made actually a very decent picture. I think it cost about $750,000. And Mr. Hughes looked at it and he set out to make a great picture of it. So a year or two later and a couple of million dollars later, it came out again. You know, he redid it. I think we remade it probably two more times.
Hughes' obsessive remounting and reshooting of the picture was an attempt to satisfy himself about the effective presentation of Jane Russell. A star new to RKO, though she had been under personal contract to Hughes for 10 years.
4 little miles from San Bernardino, 3 little miles from San Bernardino. My bag was packed and ready. I said to myself, steady, 2 more miles and you're in heaven.
His Kind of Woman was a very pivotal picture. It was the first time that Robert Mitchum was starred with Jane Russell. Mr. Hughes was very concerned that this hottest team ever to hit the screen, which is a line that he liked very much, would promote and could make the motion picture successful. The painting that I did, he just enjoyed very, very much. I think only once did he say to me, would you lower the décolletage a little bit, about a half inch here, and move it down to about a quarter of an inch here. But never made any other comment than that. One evening, he spent a half hour on the couch with me in Beverly Hills just discussing the thickness of a shirt. Now, obviously, the thickness of a shirt had to do with a garment that was, in this particular case, on Jane Russell. And he wanted me to understand very clearly how the thickness of the shirt would appear as it was against human flesh. But he was painstaking to make certain that I understood not the thickness of a pocket, not the thick. He would repeat it over and over again, and then would always ask, you understand what I mean? I would say, yes, Mr. Hughes, I do. And then he would go over it again, and when you left, it was impressed in your mind exactly what he had in mind to do.
Your clothes were very much part of your being the actress you were at that time.
Yes, and the clothes usually, you know, were strapless, or they couldn't be terribly what I would call chic, or what I might buy myself, but they were, Michael could design beautiful things. But they always had to have, you know, the movie star image or something.
Mr. Hughes involved himself, did he not, in your clothes a great deal?
Drove us absolutely crazy. And he did all this on the telephone with Michael Wolff. And then poor Michael, would have to come and tell me. And then I would disagree, and I'd argue, and I'd holler and yell, and Michael would have to go back and tell Mr. Hughes yes or no or what. And so the argument went on. You know, I'd hate to be in his shoes, but it was fun from where I was.
The only time he ever gave me instructions was always on a picture with Jane Russell. It was a Sunday night, and the phone rang, and they told me, Mr. Hughes will see me. Where are you? And I told them where I was, and they started to calculate and add and subtract, and they figured if I left then, it would take me 22 and a half minutes to get to the Samuel Goldwyn studio. And then they said, when I get there, blink my lights, and then the gate man would let me in. And then the car on the lot would blink their lights, follow that car, and that's the way it went. He could have easily had an office at RKO, but he didn't. This time he met me at his office on the Samuel Goldwyn lot. A very, very bare, nothing office, a desk, a chair, an overhead light. And this connected to his own private projection room.
Do you mind if I join?
Seems you have.
Hey, you sing pretty good. I thought I'd buy you a drink.
I'm drinking champagne.
I'm hip. $18 a bottle.
Champagne's not your drink.
Only on big occasions.
And this isn't?
He had the painting made. He liked it very, very much. And then one day I was told that a brilliant idea had come up, and I asked, what was this about? They said, well, we're going to do something very special. So at the RKO lot, I didn't see this being constructed, but I saw it being moved at 2 o'clock in the morning. And this was to a site at the corner of Fairfax and Wilshire Boulevard, directly across from the May Company. There was a large parking lot there and a restaurant which no longer exists. And they put on that corner a huge gilded frame, like a masterpiece, if you will. This was all framed, gold-leafed, and the center was going to house my painting, 20, 30 times the size of the original, if not 100 times the size. It was enormous. The painting was completed. But while that was going on, people were passing by, and cars were going by, and they were monitoring how many vehicles would pass the corner. Mr. Hughes had an idea that to emphasize the concept of the hottest combination ever to hit the screen, that they would have two or three or four large gas jets throw flames up into the air about 20 or 30 feet high. Now, everybody thought this was marvelous. And that it would be certainly an exciting event to have this happen. And these gas jets would go up. They would be programmed every so many minutes to flame up. And I was there, and I saw all the gas people coming. All the pipes were being put up, and the tests were being made with short gas jets, and the publicity people were there. And while all of that was going on, a phone call came. It was stop everything. Well, it seemed that there was something on the docket that we were not aware of. It came out in the newspapers later, some kind of dealings with Hughes and the City Fathers, and well advised that maybe they would have been very irate that this was going on, and the possibility that those jets going up into the air were prone for accidents for motorists passing by who wouldn't expect that thing to occur. And he just said, I just wanted you to know, he used to call me Zampi. He said, I want you to know, Zampi, that sometimes, he said, things happen where we just have to change plans. So I guess I had a very sad look on my face, you know, so he made a fist and clumped me on the jaw, and he says, you gotta learn to roll with the punches. And I said, yes, Mr. Hughes. It was a very short meeting, but it was his concern that I found very, very moving for me, and that there were other instances like that where he always showed his humanity.
3 days after assuming control of the studio, he sent for me. And I hadn't seen him for years. And now I'm married, happily married, I have a child and so forth. And he as much as said, no, you're not happy. I said, yes, I am, Howard, I'm very happy. And I have a child and I'm, you know, really very happy. No, you're not. You're not happy. Not really happy. Not deep down inside you're not happy. You know, he couldn't understand it. And I said, yes, I am. Well, as long as I own the studio, you won't work. That ought to get you. And I said, it will put an end to my career. He said, yes, I guess it will. I said, then I will just keep having babies, Howard. He said, you'll be paid every week. I said, thank you. And at that time, I was making about $2,500 a week because they had renegotiated the contract. And he meant it. And I was stopped dead in my tracks.
He was very stylized and European in his approach to pictures.
He wanted you to be like Marlene Dietrich.
Well, that was his image, you know, and he'd go to Mitch and say things like, what are we going to do with this stupid girl, you know? And Mitch would look at him and...
Hi.
Hey.
How'd you do?
I don't know yet.
Did you catch my act? I didn't exactly fracture the people, did I?
Oh, I'd say you were doing all right for yourself.
How about a lift,
Hop in.
Now, what would Mr. Halloran say?
Look, I'll choose my own friends, if you don't mind.